It's the 4A State Baseball Championship here in the state of Illinois. It's Providence Catholic versus Lyons. And good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to high school baseball on the IHSA television website. I'm Scott Slocum, along with Mark Lindo, assistant coach at Naperville North, and a state champion with Aurora Central way back when in 1983, a second place finish in 84. So if anyone knows what it's like to play in a game this big, it's you, my friend.
Awesome night, awesome atmosphere. We got the best of the best down there this evening. A big crowd all the way from the left field line to the right field line. I love it. Electricity here. It's showtime.
It is.
Here at Silver Cross Field.
Sophia Minnett is the third member of our broadcast crew. We'll check in with her throughout the course of this evening. This one should be good. Providence Catholic expected to be here. The preseason number one team. They're 37-3. They've rolled over everyone. Lyons 36-4, and if you ask them, they expected to be here as well.
Well, Lyons has done it with a vast array of balance between pitching, hitting, defense. As you see, the Lyons team taking the field, and Providence has done it with the mash men, if you will, along with some outstanding pitching, seven Division I prospects. They just keep coming at you and coming at you. Two outstanding baseball teams in an outstanding venue here tonight, Silver Cross Field in Joliet, and I expect a very, very well played baseball game.
Lineups, first of all, for the guys in those dark uniforms. Providence Catholic, Kevin DeFilippis is the second baseman. He'll lead off. Joe Houlihan, the shortstop, bats second. Batting third, the power hitting, the Chicago Sun-Times Player of the Year, Sammy Travis, the third baseman. Danny Potempa, the catcher, will bat fourth. Colin McInnery, the first baseman, will bat fifth. Zach Katsoulis, the right fielder, bats sixth. Batting seventh is the left fielder, Dominic Ulstup. Matt Trowbridge, the winning pitcher yesterday, he will DH and bat eighth. And Brady Wilkin is the center fielder. He will bat ninth. So it's DeFilippis, Houlihan, Travis, Potempa, McInerney, Katsoulis, Ulsta, Trowbridge, and Wilkin. And they will be facing a young man who's never lost a game in high school on the varsity level, Connor Cuff.
Unbelievable. Connor Cuff comes into tonight's ballgame on the season 10-0. But as Scott alluded to, 18-0. Unheard of. Get a good picture of the tall right-hander on his career, 18-0. This season, 1.02 earned run average, 62 innings pitched. He's punched out 90 opponent hitters and walked just 12. That's right, 90 strikeouts, 12 walks, giving up just 39 hits. Connor Cuff has a tough task, and that's setting down this omnipotent Providence Celtic lineup tonight. And here to call the 2011 State 4A State Championship game and the last game of the IHSA calendar season, here is Scott Slocum.
Thank you, Coach. Celtics will send up DeFilippis, Houlihan, and Travis. It's one of the, if not the most potent 1-2-3 lineup in the state of Illinois. This is one of the great offensive teams of all time in the state of Illinois as well.
No doubt they can hit you with small ball, hit gaps, and hit the ball over the wall.
First pitch of the state championship game, an 85-mile-an-hour fastball to DeFilippis for strike one.
Matilla Valley, Bennett Academy, Neuqua Valley, Downer South, Edwardsville, all were the beaten opponents by Providence along the way until the state tournament.
Curveball in there, beauty for strike. Providence is killing people in the last three games here in the state tournament. They've outscored the opposition 34-7.
It was Prospect that took the brunt of that offense yesterday. 9 runs put on the board by the Celtics.
DeFilippis hits the ball on the ground to the shortstop. Easy play for Mahoney, and Spencer fires across to Rotemoyer. One up, one down for Cuff and the Lions here in the top of the first inning.
Spencer Mahoney from Valparaiso. He's going to Valparaiso. Very slick fielding shortstop. Nice range, nice speed, handles the bat. Makes that first play look easy against DeFilippis.
Houlihan, a ho-hum 6 home run season, but when you compare that to Potempa and Travis, doesn't mean a whole lot. There's a shot, first pitch right at the center fielder, Brian Kelly. Drifts a little bit to his left, he's got it, and two up and two down here in the top of the first.
Flag left center field here at Silver Cross, blowing from left to right, maybe knocking balls down that would be in the gap in left center field.
Hey, here's Sammy Travis now. Do you remember what this kid did yesterday with a first pitch fastball?
Well, there he was, the end result of a ball that went big time deep. There it is. Load him up and watch it go. Look at the center fielder. He just turns it back. Big bounce. DLG. Definitely long gone.
There's another one. First pitch. Curveball this time. Over the left field fence. And Sam Travis has 17 home runs on the year. 74 RBIs. And the Celtics up 1-0 on the Lyons.
Sam Travis, you queued him up from yesterday. Cue it up again. I would love to get a picture out of the concrete there. Way past the party deck. Because that one, DLG, definitely long gone. Sammy Travis put a charge into that hanging breaking ball and brings Celtics feet fans on their feet as one.
Brad Taylor went out and talked to Cuff and wanted to calm him down facing Travis. And here's Pontepa now, takes a fastball strike. Got a curveball on a tee, bam, out of here. Unbelievable, on cue. Pontepa hits this one in the air, the infield. Cuff was called off by the first baseman. To his knees goes Rotemoyer, and he makes the catch. But Sam Travis, the Chicago Sun-Times Player of the Year, makes his presence felt early. 1-0 Celtics after half an inning in the 4A state championship game here in Joliet. Lions trailing 1-0. They'll get their shot here in the bottom of the first inning. Let's give you the lineup for the Lions from Lyons Township. Spencer Mahoney, the shortstop, will lead off. Steve Eilenbach, the second baseman, will bat second. Brian Rotemoyer, the first baseman, will bat third. Designated hitter Tom Walsh will bat fourth. The pitcher Connor Cuff will hit fifth. Third baseman Keith Lehman will bat sixth. Mike Pett, the right fielder, will bat seventh. Brian Kelly, the center fielder, will bat eighth. And Dan Zay, the left fielder, will bat ninth. So again, it's Mahoney, Eilenbach, Rotemoyer, Walsh, Cuff, Lehman, Pett, Kelly, and Zay. And they will be facing a big, strong right-hander from Providence Catholic, Brandon Magalonis, who comes in with an 8-2 record.
6'3", 190 pounds of chiseled athlete. Magalonis wearing that big number 18 on his Providence jersey. Has a 1-0 lead to take into this ballgame. An 8-2 record, 59 and a third innings pitched. A 2.48 earned run average against very good competition. 78 strikeouts, 28 walks on the season. And Sam Travis, long home run, has given Providence a 1-0 lead and ignited this crowd down the first baseline, filled with an awful lot of green.
Yeah, if we can get a shot, and I know our guys will, of the crowd down the first baseline. I mean, Lyons brought a lot of people, a lot. But Providence Catholic has packed their side of Silver Cross Field here. I mean, it's one of the great state championship crowds we've seen. Magalonis' first pitch, fastball, 89 on the gun. He can bring it. And there's that crowd. Look at the people here from New Lenox. Now, keep in mind, New Lenox, as the crow flies, is about 7 or 8 miles away, so they should have a big crowd. There's a shot right up the middle off the bat of Mahoney. Almost took the head of Magalonis off. Two pitches, base hit right up the gut. And Lyons has the tying run aboard here in the bottom of the first.
Mahoney came into the tournament, 453 hitter, bang, there's why. Fastball down away, keeps his hands inside, throws the head of the bat, and turns Magalonis right around. That's why he's a Division I recruit to Valparaiso University. And even though he has some size to him, he runs really well to Spencer Mahoney, who goes about 6'3", 195 in athletic.
Here's Island back now, the second baseman. Quick throw over to first base. Magalonis has a good move for a big guy, really quick with his feet.
It's all about the feet, Scott. It's not about the throw. Yes, a quick snap throw, but how quickly that spin pivot takes place.
The pitch from Magalonis, a fastball, swung on and missed by Eilenbach for strike one.
Magalonis about 87, 88 miles an hour on that one. And because of that, Brady Wilkham was playing way in right center field. Now he's moved back just about straight up Providence Celtic defense, giving an awful lot of room in the right center field gap as Zach Katsoulis way over by the cutout area in right field.
Eilenbach, 358 hitter, three homers, 29 knocked in, 38 hits on the year. Curveball, a beauty for a strike.
Now, breaking balls, we've talked about this throughout the weekend. Some breaking balls are more sliders and come across hard but don't change planes. It looks like Magalonis went with a 12-6 curveball, the ball falling from 12 o'clock on the face of a clock straight down to 6.
This pitch is fouled out of play onto Jefferson Street down the right field line. It's interesting, the lead of Mahoney has shrunk with those two throws from Magallonis over to first base.
He's got quick feet, does Magallonis, but somewhat high leg move. He's getting up there in about 1.35, about 1.4 with a curveball. Can they guess correctly when they run?
Curveball swung on and fouled at the feet of Danny Potempa, the catcher, so life still for Heilenbach.
Over first base, Mahoney, he tips his cap to George Ischella, his third base coach. That's the sign within the sign that he knows I can go when I want.
Best ball upstairs. One ball and two strikes on Heilenbach. Brian Rotemoyer, the first baseman, is on deck. 1-0 Providence here, bottom of the first. Sam Travis, a 380-foot shot well over the left field fence, has given Providence the lead. There's a fastball that just missed down low, 2-2.
Middle infield of Providence, Houlihan at short, DeFilippis at second. You'll see them have an open with their gloves over their mouth. That's either an open mouth or closed mouth. That tells each other who's covering the base on a would-be steal.
A shot over the second baseman's head into the gap. There goes Mahoney on his way to third base. And back-to-back singles by Mahoney and Heilenbach. And the Lyons Township Lions in business here in the bottom of the first, trying to tie the game and even take the lead.
Heilenbach worked the count back to 2-2, got a breaking ball that just spun. Magallonis didn't finish that pitch as his shortstop Houlihan comes in. Houlihan, the quarterback, of course, comes in and takes that leadership position, picks up his pitcher. First and third defense being called now by Dan Potempa, stepping up in front of home plate. He's got a tough run in the 400 hitting Rotemeyer in the three hole here.
And that curveball just rolled up there, didn't it?
It did. Not much going.
Rotemoyer, 10 home runs, 43 knocked in, 400 average. And the table is set here. Runners at the corners with nobody out. Magallonis in trouble. This pitch is fouled out of play right behind the backstop.
Rotemeyer, a Division I player in his own right. I know there's a litany, a long list of Providence people going Division I, six seniors and the junior.
15 in all for Providence
Catholic.
Yeah, playing
college baseball, unbelievable. But Rotemeyer, he'll be playing the Missouri Valley next year at Illinois State.
Magallonis checks each runner. He'll go to first. Lights are on here at Silver Cross Field. It's been a cloudy, dreary day. We had about 5 minutes of sunshine. That was at the start of the third place game, which, by the way, was won by Prospect 2-1.
Jalen Knights have already won the 3A championship today.
There's a shot down the left field line. That is fair. And Lyons has tied up the game. Ball gets underneath the glove of Olsta. This will give the Lions the lead. On his way home is Heilenbach. He will score to make it 2-1. Hit and an error. On the left fielder, Dominic Olsta, and Magallonis is not fooling anyone. Three balls all crushed off the bat of the Lions.
Lions fans in appreciation, but Rotemeyer, another breaking ball, spin. No bite to it at all. He just laces that ball down the left field line. And then coming up in the bullpen area, Olsta tried to climb the hill. The ball went right underneath him, allowing the second run to score. An error on the left fielder, but Rotemeyer just flat out turned on that breaking ball, got his top hand through the ball. And Lyons, the off factor, is definitely gone already in the face of the Lions.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. I mean, they are putting the bat on the ball big time against Magallonis. Timeout is called here as Chris Carlson, the pitching coach, wants to go out and talk with Magallonis. And they got to do something about that curveball if Providence wants to win this game, because it's not happening.
Yesterday in the complete game victory, Matt Trowbridge just gave up 4 hits in the one run. The 9-1 victory had, and already 4 hits on the board for Lions.
So Rotemoyer gets one RBI on that one. And now they're squaring to bunt. This is Tom Walsh, the DH, and he fouls it back to the screen. Thinking maybe Coach Ischella here says, let's get that runner over to third. Let's get 3 runs on the board. I got Cuff on the mound. That might be enough.
Absolutely. And obviously my error, 3 hitters and 3 hits on the board. I looked at the scoreboard, and that was my first mistake. But going back to your comment about the bunt, Walsh sees that Sam Travis is playing back in the cutout. A lot of pressure on him with the runner on second. If you can bunt the ball higher to the third baseman, you get yourself a drag bunt base hit.
Squared to bunt again and takes low. 1 ball and 1 strike. 2 on the board here for Lyons. They lead 2-1, still no one out. Runner at second base is Rotemoyer.
This is the eighth and final game of this weekend in Joliet. We have seen some outstanding fundamental bunting throughout this tournament. Well-coached, well-disciplined teams.
Wall squares, pulls the bat back, chops it right over the mound. Shortstop, nice play. That Tulahan on to McInerney. And they get the runner there. Nice job by Walsh. Wanted to bunt, couldn't get it down, swung away, got the runner to third with only one out.
That is a very fundamental play by Lyons Township's Walsh, but a very fine play as well by Houlihan, raging far to his left, and he got the real short hop.
Mm-hmm.
He gave with it, soft hands, nice run through as he threw a strike across to McInerney.
Houlihan, very nice shortstop, one of the better fielding shortstops in the state. Here's Cuff now, chance to help out his own cause. Breaking ball, a beauty. That one just didn't roll up there. Strike one. Runner at third base is Rotemoyer. He's there with one out, two in already for the Lions. They lead 2-1 here in the bottom of the first.
Magalonis committed, signed with Northwestern. No off factor by LT.
Spanked right at the second baseman. DeFilippis bats it down, throws on to McInerney. And there's two away, but that does score a run. Providence chose to play the infield back with one out, coach, and it cost him a run.
Well, two things. One, great job moving the runner over by Walsh that he could score on Connor Cuff's RBI. And two, I totally agree with Mark Smith and that decision. He has so much confidence in his offense. He wants to stay out of a big inning, get the sure out, get his team back to the plate where they can be incredibly dangerous.
Lehman faces Magalonis here with two outs and the bases clean. Takes ball one inside. But still, every ball except for the dribbler over the mound from Walsh has been spanked. There's a strike, 1-1.
Tipping 90 on that pitch. Again, if we get some shots of the miles per hour on the First Midwest Bank, always add two to that. They say that Glenn is 2 miles off, so he tipped 90, did Magalonis, on that fastball.
It's a pitch inside, two balls and a strike. Lions 36-4. Their losses this year: Naperville Central, York, Downers Grove South, and Downers Grove South. It's only three teams have beaten them this year. Curveball hit in the air, right field. This is Katsoulis drifting over into foul ground, battling with the bullpen mound, the fence, and a bunch of little kids running at him, and he makes the catch. But what an impressive inning for the Lions. They score three times, three hits, nobody left. We've played one. Game on. Lions 3, Providence 1 in the 4A state championship game. Top of the second inning we go. It's 3-1 in favor of Lions. Third member of our broadcast crew is Sophia Minert down in the field. Sophia, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Scott and Mark. You guys touched on it in the open. Providence Catholic, everybody expected and wanted them to be here in this championship game, except for maybe themselves. Talking with Mark Smith before the game, he said, we never talked about state championship. We never talked about coming here to Joliet. He said we had one goal at the beginning of the season, and that was to win our last game. He said, again, we never talked about championships. All we wanted to do was win our last game and just get better every single day. He said this team has worked tremendously hard to get to this point, and he's extremely proud of them. Now, in the other dugout, George Ushala, before the game, he told me, hey, we really think the two best teams are here, and that's not always the case in baseball. Both coaches said this game is the hardest one to win because you never know what can happen. And George Ushala said, you know, we know Providence Catholic is the real deal. We know they have no holes in their game, but we can do things pretty well ourselves, too. He said we have a lot of confidence in Connor. He's a very emotional pitcher, says he shows his passion for the game on the mound, but will handle any situation very well. Guys, back up to you.
Well, he's handled them 18 times in a row in high school. Connor Cuff has yet to lose a game, and he's taken to a 3-1 lead. Kyle McInerney digging in here and has a one ball and two strike count against him. Top of the second inning, Providence scored a run on a Sam Travis home run, and then Lions came right back and scored three of their own.
Connor Cuff, 18-0, as we mentioned, a mid-80s fastball, good off speed. Bulldog on the mound. He pitches ornery. He pitches with a swagger.
Swing and a miss by McInerney. First strikeout of the afternoon of a Celtic. That'll bring up the right fielder, Zach Katsoulis.
Well, that fastball ran away from McInerney, who did not have a good approach. When you pitch away, you got to hit it away. You're not going to catch up to mid-80s by trying to turn on it. You have to change your mental approach when you have two strikes.
Another left-handed hitter, Providence with a plethora of them. Strike one from Connor Cuff. This is a position Providence has not been in many times this year, down. There's ball one. And you saw Mark Smith, as Sophia was talking about, the young head coach of Providence Catholic, and he hasn't had the stomach churning too much this year. They've been dominating people, but he knows today that Lyons is outstanding. He's got his work cut out for him. I know Schmitty well, and tell you what, the wheels are turning inside that head right now.
Played his college ball, McMurray.
There's a shot right up the gut. Brian Kelly waits for it. Two away.
Among his accolades, Mark Smith is a 2010 Catholic League Longest Coach of the Year and learned under Jaime Garcia, Butch Markells, and then at Joliet Junior College was an associate coach with that fine program there, Wayne King.
Here's Dominic Ulsta, the left fielder. And Wayne has won a couple of state or a couple of national championships, head coach of the Wolves. And Mark always was the heir apparent, but Wayne's not going anywhere. He loves it. And Mark wanted to become a head coach on his own, went to Providence Catholic, and what a job he's done there. He's turned, you know, the program's always been good, but the facility there, probably the finest high school facility around. He built a clubhouse that's better than anything you've seen in the majors for his players.
Tom Deedon Field. Tom Deedon came back and spoke to his team earlier and said it was a highly motivational night for his players. And Tom Deedon talked about integrity and class, and that's something that both of these programs, Lyons Township and Providence Catholic, both have. That's a great deal of character in their baseball programs. Good, clean, but hard playing athletes.
Dominic Ulsta heading to count here. Two balls and a strike. The left fielder. Fastball down low. 3-1 the count now. Again, 2-1 the score. Top of the second. Sun trying to fight its way out of the clouds.
Ulster trying to disrupt the timing. Connor Cuff wants to work quickly. Ulster gets to load up. He's sitting dead red on a 3-1 fastball.
Ball four. Ulster had a good day yesterday with a couple knocked in against Prospect. Gets a two-out walk. Now we see Matt Trowbridge digging from the left side. Trowbridge, what a performance yesterday. He's a winning pitcher. He's hitting 88, 89 on the gun, and at 5'10", 170, you wonder how that guy can throw it that hard, but he can.
Seven innings pitch, gave up just four hits, was around the plate completely, only one base on balls. Total command of that semifinal victory.
Two homers, 15 knocked in with a 357 average, couple of throws over to first base to keep Ulster honest over there.
How about your eight hitter hitting 357?
Yeah.
And then you turn the lineup over to your nine hitter, the junior Wilkin going to Bradley, who's hitting 420 in the nine hole.
The Cuff isn't missing by much. That one just outside. One on, two outs here in the top of the second. The pitch in there for a strike. 1-1.
The Lyons Township Lyons defense playing straight away, but the respect. Brian Kelly is a mile deep in center field. One more step and he's on the track straight away.
Beautiful straight change from Cuff. Trowbridge way out in front of it.
Did a circle change. He turned it over the last second. So the ball not only was 8 to 10 miles off, but actually ran away from the left-handed hitter.
Went with it again, just missed outside. Back-to-back straight changes. This one floats a little bit high, a little bit outside. It's 2-2.
And he took even more off it, so changing speeds on the changeup.
A pitch, fastball hit in the air to center field. Kelly will have a long run in. The right fielder actually is going to call him off. That's Pett, and that's it for the Celtics. So Cuff, a quiet second inning, gives up a walk, but that's it. We go to the bottom of the second. The 4A state championship, the Lyons from Lyons Township, lead the Celtics from Providence Catholic 3-1. Folks are happy. They're wearing blue and gold. That means they're with Lyons Township, a 3-1 lead. We go to the bottom of the second inning. Lyons will send up Pett, Kelly, and Zay. That's 7, 8, and 9. And George Ushula's very, very potent lineup.
Mike Pett, a 308 hitter in the seven hole. He received a Chick Evans scholarship, and he'll attend the University of Colorado, so a class young man, Chick Evans golf scholarship.
Of course, that's from the Western Golf Association. An association that has a lot of ties here in the Chicagoland area and in the Joliet area, with Coghill Golf and Country Club in Lamont being the host of the Western Open, now the BMW Championship. It's a ground ball. Houlihan, the shortstop, on the short hop over to McHenry. One away here in the bottom of the second. And I was up at Cog Hill the other day. Just a wonderful place.
Shot a 72?
After about 12, 13 holes. Talked to Frank Jemsek and the owner of Cog Hill. And, of course, talked a lot about the Chick Evans Foundation and how wonderful it is and how many kids have benefited. And Pet is one of those kids.
Absolutely. Pet, a class act and very astute student and a very good right fielder.
Kelly is the center fielder. The bottom third in their order goes the right fielder, the center fielder, and the left fielder.
Well, Lyons advanced yesterday, that 4-1 win, just flat out shutting down Mount Carmel. And how about the job that Zach Rema just did as he brewed his record 11-0.
There's a foul ball out of play.
Six innings, he struck out three, gave up only five hits. And Rema, just the story about him is he was out last year. He had a collapsed lung in the spring, then had a relapse in the summer, as Sophia told us. Came back, and it could be a relapse anytime, but he was out on the hill spinning his team from the semifinal into tonight's title tilt.
Off-speed pitch misses down low. Two balls and a strike to Brian Kelly. 3-1, Lyons leads. Bottom of the second inning. It's a ground ball. This time Houlihan has to go to his right. Fields cleanly, long throw, safe. Good call.
What a great play by Houlihan. Far in the hole, he got around that baseball so that you'll see him get around the ball. I'll tell you what, Kelly runs well. He's a quarterback of their 10-2 football team. But look at how he's able to get around the ball, get his momentum back toward the base. But either after the good stretch by McHenry, the fleet feet of Brian Kelly, the quarterback for the 10-2 Lyons, gets the safe call.
Here's Danny Zay now. Dan playing left field today. Plays a little infield as well. 340 batting average with 19 knocked in. Fastball swung on and missed for strike one. His name is spelled Z-E-H-E. Kind of wonder how they got Zay out of that, don't you?
I don't know. The Zay-Hey kid, I guess.
Ooh, that one hit him, didn't it? Nope, hit the bat instead. Wow. I didn't hear any pink of the aluminum. I heard flesh.
That ball runs right in on his hands.
That was his fist, yep.
Quickly in the hole, 0-2.
Is that what happens with age? Eyes start to go?
Exactly.
Is that it?
You're a witness.
Wasn't even close to hitting his shoulder. There goes the runner. Pitch bounces in. Pontepa won't even have a chance. That is a stolen base.
So that's a situation where George Uchella, the third base coach, lets Kelly on his own. But usually at the big league level, an 0-2 pitch is not a good pitch to run on. But at this level, you get so many breaking balls on 0-2. You guess correctly, and you get an easy stolen base. Kelly moves into scoring position.
It's the 1-2 to Zay. Fastball just misses. 2-2. You got to like what Lyons is doing. They're aggressive. They're taking it right at Providence Catholic. And, Coach, you couldn't be any more right when you said the awe factor is out of this game now.
No, Lyons Township, you know, they have a state title under their belt with George Uchella earlier in his career in 2003. Both these teams have state titles. Providence, what, 1982? That Mike Tashita-led team went on to pitch at Iowa. So both these programs have been there, done that, and Lyons has had some great summer success, has not been to the state tournament series since 2004, I believe, was their last appearance. Or 2006 when they did not place. They finished 34-7.
What an at bat here by Zay. 2-2. Curveball swung on and missed for strike three. The curveball starting to improve a little bit. That is the first strikeout for Magallonis. Now we go back up to the top of the order, and here is Spencer Mahoney, who got everything started for the Lyons with a shot single up the middle, eventually scored a run on a base hit by Ryan Rotemoyer.
Mahoney was, as we mentioned, going to Valpo as a shortstop, was an outstanding jump shooter for Lyons Township, super sectional basketball team. He actually was the 4A three-point shooting champion down in Peoria.
Fastball upstairs. Man after my own heart, love the round ball. He's having a good baseball tournament here so far. In a game plus, he's 2-for-4. Runner has his lead at second base. That's Kelly. The pitch is over the outside corner. And if the first Midwest Bank gun is right, He hit 90 miles an hour on that pitch.
Picking up steam, no doubt about that. We saw the third place game, Landwehr. Remember, he was starting about 84, 85, and he was finishing the game at 88, 89. He was picking up gas as the game went along.
Another fastball misses upstairs. 87 there.
Now, that's a really good last two-pitch take by Mahoney. He was 1-0, and yes, he took a strike, but he took a pitcher strike from Magallonis. That one, he lays off the fastball again, trying to get to a favorable count with a ball in his zone. One spot, one pitch, one area.
Here comes the 2-1. Upstairs, 3-1. Now, Magallonis, we talked about his 8-2 record on the season. 78 strikeouts in 59 innings. It's a lot of K's, but today just doesn't have to seem that strikeout pitch. He hasn't found it yet. 3-1 high and outside. There's first walk he's given up here today.
Good at bat by Mahoney. Tip your cap, he had a base open. I don't know if Magallonis was pitching around him or not, but he definitely wasn't going to give in at center, cut one. A lot of times a pitcher will try to let a batter get himself out by chasing a bad ball. Mahoney, too much of a cerebral player for that. So they put the RBI situation in the hands of Heilenbach.
Runners at first and second, two outs here. Heilenbach singled his last time up, hit the ball hard as well. Magallonis ready from the stretch. Bender, a beauty, strike one.
Now he's starting to go over the top more, 12-6 with his breaking ball. When he was coming from trying to cut the ball, he wasn't getting any action at all. The ball was hit hard in that first inning. Now he's getting fingers on top, finishing with his hands to the sky, and getting more bite on the ball downward.
There was an off-speed pitch there, and on the fist, fouled down the third baseline by Heilenbach. So Magallonis looking for a punch out. He has just one the first time through the order. And against a good hitting team like this, who will put the bat on the ball, you need some strikeouts. Take a little of that pressure off your defense, because they will hit it hard. Here's the 0-2. Hit high in the air, foul ground. McHenry going over toward the tarp. He'll run out of room. And what wind we do have is blowing in from center field. We're in the third place game, it was more left to right. Now this is a northeast wind. That would explain the 68 degree game time temperature.
There's a stiff flag.
Boy, on cue, we get a gust right here into the booth.
Had the jacket on all day. We went from 97 on Wednesday and Thursday to jackets tonight. Baseball in Illinois.
Two strikes, the count, the pitch, down in the dirt. Good stop by Pontempa.
Good pitch by Magallonis. I thought his first 0-2 pitch that was fouled off by Heilenbach maybe caught too much of the plate. Heilenbach fouled off, couldn't catch the mistake, if you will.
Coach, he's throwing 88. He's got a curveball at 72, 73. What's up with the strikeouts being down here today?
I don't know. He does not have the late movement. You want movement, velocity, and placement. He's not getting his ball to move as much as he'd like.
Well, guess what there? That one moved, fell off the table. Struck him out. Heilenbach down by way of the K. We played 2, Lyons 3, Providence 1. This is the 4A state championship game on IHSA TV, and what a curveball that was. We're in Joliet at Silver Cross Field, and if you're sitting in the stands, you look out over right field, you see that building right there. Not the one close in your picture, but the one a little bit further away. That's Joliet Central. It was just named one of the most 50 interesting architectural designs in the state of Illinois. We're talking all the buildings in Chicago, all the buildings in all the old towns built with original Joliet limestone, ranked among the top 150 structures in terms of architecture in the state, along with two other buildings here in Joliet, Union Station right behind us and the Rialto Square Theater. So congratulations to Joliet Central. That school, two blocks long,
That's
two city
amazing.
Blocks long.
Yeah.
And now we have a bit of a controversy at home plate. Hit batsman. The home plate umpire didn't look like he was going to call it. Mark Smith came down to argue, and Brady Wilkins like, hey, man, I got hit with that curveball. And now George Uchella is out as well to talk.
Paul Schultz first off called hit by pitch. Then he said no, and then he changed his mind back again to see if there was a bunt attempt. And what if it's a bunt attempt, which Wilkins had a couple nice bunts yesterday. Now he's going to ask for third base coach Don Swanson's opinion. And the reason is Swanson's looking down from third base to that angle. If he attempted to make the bunt and got his bat out over the plate, it would be, you know, a situation where it would be called a ball, not a hit by pitch. We get a chance to see it in slow-mo probably. Here it comes in. There's the bunt attempt. And it came in on him and hit him on the hand. And it was not over home plate. So that is an excellent and proper call.
So Wilkin is aboard. Leadoff man. That sets the table for the top of this Providence Catholic order. Kevin DeFilippis was out short to first to lead off the ball game. 3-1 Lyons leads. Connor Cuff, 18-0 in his high school career. Quick throw over to first base. Wilkin dives back in.
90 strikeouts, 12 base on balls this year. Just a phenomenal K to walk ratio.
First pitch is a strike. DeFilippis with some incredible numbers from that leadoff spot. 3 home runs, 31 knocked in, a .465 average. Another throw over to first base.
And 51 runs scored. Always look for one run scored from a leadoff man. He gets on, he gets in.
There's a shot into left field, a base hit. So a hit batsman, then a line shot. That was a fastball. That's how good a hitter he is. At 84, 85 mile an hour fastball, he hit it like he hits a changeup, pulls it.
Well, he's sitting dead red on one. He loads up the backside. Right on contact, great hitters. Their lead leg locks out like a break. Their hips come through the ball. Their back heel goes to the sky. When all of those things come together, the lower part of the body, you can hit the ball hard and with authority.
Joe Houlihan, a .357 hitter, is squaring. He takes a curveball, strike one. Trying to get the table loaded for Travis. Though if the bunt is successful here, you know what's going to happen to Sam Travis.
Open base, base on balls.
So what do you do here, coach?
I still think I'd move him over. I really do. And then take my shot with the bases juiced.
Swing it away and fouls it right back at us.
We haven't had one in the booth all weekend. We're 0 for 8 games.
Well, that almost hit my broadcasting partner, my friends over at WJL Radio. Steve Brandy should have caught that one.
Gerard Aguirre also.
Yeah, Coach Rod's over there.
Big time coach in his own right.
Curveball spanked into left field. This is right at Zay. Everybody will have to scamper back. Pretty close play at second base. It was a line shot, but right at him.
He squared that ball up, but playing perfectly was Dan Zay as Houlihan just squared it up big time.
Now look at everybody rise to their feet. There's very few people in baseball. Whatever you're doing, you stop the watch. This kid, you stop the watch. Sam Travis, a home run his last time up, fastball outside, ball one. So far in this tournament, here in Joliet, he's hit 2 home runs, 800 feet worth of home runs. One at 420 yesterday, one at 380 today. Here comes the 1-0 from Cuff. Upstairs, 2-0.
Mark Smith said this about Sam Travis, the Sun-Times Player of the Year. It's a great quote from Coach Smith. He matured from a great hitter to a phenomenal one. Now, those are a couple adjectives, great and phenomenal.
Pickoff play at second. They got the runner if they want him. Wilkin being chased back towards second base. He is out. What a mistake in base running by Brady Wilkin. 2 outs now.
That was a set play. We talked about Mahoney and his cerebral approach to the game. He saw something, and then he signaled a counter cuff, and the leg move gets him the spin, the high leg to spin, and then Mahoney takes the throw. They execute the rundown. Not textbook, but well enough to get it done. Big play by the LT defense.
And try yet for another pickoff, but DeFilippis is back in. You know, everybody gives pitchers grief when they do the fake third, fake first, or when they do the hang like that. It works. Travis fists this one up the line. First baseman Rotemoyer has it, steps on the bag, and what looked like a huge inning in the making, Providence is shut down.
On their feet, the third base side making some noise as well. The Lyons came out roaring defensively right there.
Top of the third, 3-1 Lyons over Providence Catholic. There's a team who had a tough weekend here in Joliet. Mount Carmel, the couple of losses, a fourth place finish, but they're living up to their word, Coach.
Well, you know, Brian Hurry said he'd be here supporting his Catholic League colleagues, Providence. Great deal of respect between the two programs. And the caravan, as one down the right field line, relaxed, but cheering for the Celtics here tonight. Full respect for Lyons Township, but you know what? Conference affiliation carries some weight.
You bet it does. Providence and Mount Carmel have been knocking heads and locking horns for years. And here is Rotemoyer, Walsh, and Cuff, 3-4-5. For the Lyons Township Lions, Rotemoyer with the RBI. There's a fastball, misses inside, quickly 2-0. It was his hit down the left field line that got under the glove of Dominic Olsta, rolled into the corner. Would have scored Mahoney anyway, but then Heilenbach came in to score. And then Rotemaier scored on a ground ball off the bat of Connor Cuff. That's where we're at, 3-1. There's a strike, 2-1 count now on Rotemaier.
Rotemaier 2 out of 3 yesterday, 1 out of 1 today, so a good start for the future Illinois State University Redbird.
There's a curveball hit in the gap. That is going to fall, and that is going to go for extra bases. Rotemaier on his way to second, and he will be in. Leadoff double for Brian Rotemaier, and old man momentum is all wearing blue and gold right now. I tell you what, going back to the top of that inning, Providence Catholic first and second, one out with their stud at the plate as we see Rotemaier just take a hanging breaking ball to right.
Yeah, he took a breaking ball, and you know that it had a little bit of late bite, but he was able to stay with it, get the ball down, didn't try to do what he shouldn't do, and that's pull it. He just drove it the right center field gap. Long run for Kasulis, who got it in. Stand up double. Rotemaier 4 out of 5 in the tournament.
And see if Walsh is bunting. He tried to bunt his last time up, eventually ended up grounding out, and he will put the ball down, and he fouls it. But still, that crazy play with Wilkin getting picked off on the hanging
leg
pick move by,
yep,
by Cuff. And then Travis, we didn't mention that as we went to break, swung at a really bad ball, and that's uncharacteristic of him.
Well, I think he was, you know, he's just all geeked up. You got to stay within yourself. Providence has to play this game one pitch at a time. I think Sophia will share with their mantra about that later on. And right now they have to stay with their mantra, and that's play this game one pitch at a time.
Walsh tried to bunt and got it down. This was foul. This never made it out of the batter's box. That's two strikes now on Tom Walsh.
Now,
who's now 0 for 2 in the sacrifice department.
One thing that Mark Smith says is stay in the moment. He tells his team stay in the moment. And right now the moment is the next at bat, the next out. They can't let this one get much deeper, but with their offense definitely just chasing two, they're in this game big time.
But the way Lyons is hitting Magalonis, you figure they're going to score more. Already 5 hits through 2 innings. The 0-2, fisted foul down the third baseline. That ball hit the facade, hit some fans, bounced on top of the Providence Catholic dugout and into the Providence Catholic bench.
Championship games are won with execution. Walsh was not able to bunt the first time, but he did move the runner along with a ground ball in the middle. Can he get the inside the ball and hit it to the right side again? That's his job.
Well, he's going to do better than that. He's going to get a base hit right up the middle. Wilkin charges, fields. And everyone will stay where they're at, first and third. Kelly did not want to challenge the arm of Brady Wilkin, who threw a strike to home plate. Nice two-strike hitting there by Tom Walsh.
And you're right, he stayed within himself, and he was trying to go to right field, and did. Didn't try to take too much. You know what? Once again, Scott, that wasn't that bad a pitch. That was a breaking ball down and in by Magalonis, but ready for the challenge was a 333 hitting Walsh, who took that inside out, got it over DeFilippis well into right center field.
I bet at least 5 of the 6 hits from Lyons have been on breaking balls.
Good point.
Here's Connor Cuff, RBI ground out, his last time up. Runners at the corners, nobody out, and time is called. And Lyons threatening to run away and hide in this one. Already a 2-run lead. They have 2 on and nobody out here in the bottom of the third. Pickoff play to first, and Walsh dives back in safely.
Pretty good feat by Magalonis as well, holding Walsh closely.
A huge Providence crowd down the first baseline, holding their breath right now. Off speed pitch of beauty, and that was a straight change, and I think that's what he's got to do more of.
Yeah, he's not getting much bite on the breaking ball. He needs to become more of a fastball change pitcher this game. You know, some game it might be his breaking ball. That hasn't been his bread and butter tonight. If he makes a change, his next best pitch, so be it.
Comes the one strike pitch, spanked into right center field. This is trouble. This is going to score at least one and probably two. Walsh is rounding third. He gets the green light on his way to third as Cuff. He is out, but two-run double for Connor Cuff. And Lyons leads 5-1, and they're pulling away from the top-ranked Celtics.
Boy, that ball was just driven to right center field as Providence does indeed have somebody up in the pen. They keep going opposite field, opposite field, opposite field. That's a philosophical approach, and they're executing it well. And it was very, very much fun if you're a Lyons fan to go ahead and watch Walsh run the bases. Man, he scored from first to home like nothing. He was just loping around those bases.
There's Lehman now, and the right-handed hitting third baseman takes ball one inside. Or check that strike one. Again, it was a breaking ball, though. Activity down in that bullpen for Providence. We'll get you number here in a moment. Fastball swung on and missed, 87 miles an hour, but it's 5-1 in favor of Lyons. And you have to wonder, with a kid like Connor Cuff on the mound, who is 18-0 lifetime, is that enough? Strike three. Oh, check that. That first pitch was a ball, I thought it was. So it's one ball and two strikes.
Dan Wetzel, number two, 6'1", 45 senior. Only appeared in seven games, 2-0, warming up in the Celtic bullpen down the right field line.
Another fastball misses inside. I think Magalonis is like, you know what, I'm done with the breaking ball. I'm just throwing 88-mile-an-hour fastballs up there.
Yeah, catch me if you can. He's got a little bit more bulldog in him. He usually does, but he's got to get some more orderliness in him tonight.
2-2 fastball hit down the third baseline underneath the glove of Sam Travis. That is a base hit. Eight hits already by Lyons against Magalonis. And this is not what the Providence Catholic fans were expecting from Magalonis. That was a curveball again.
And Wetzel tips his cap down the line that he is ready. Interesting that he's warming up in right field from the windup. If he comes in the baseball game, he'll come in from the set position. He's ready, but I think somebody needs to remind him to get his warm-ups from the stretch or set position down there.
Magalonis this year in 59 innings gave up a total of 37 hits. Today in 2 1/3, he's given up 8. I mean, that's just absolutely incredible. Give credit to Lyons. They're waiting for that curveball, waiting for that curveball, and they are pouncing on it.
Here's Pet. We talked about the Evans scholarship. He'll be a Buffalo at the University of Colorado next year.
A friend of mine's son's going out there to play volleyball. He got his dorm room. We went out there, overlooks the mountains.
A little bit of majestic sight lines out there, huh?
How to be 18 years old and headed to Boulder. Understand it's a pretty great school academically and a pretty fun place to go also. There's a pitch high and outside, 2 balls and a strike, and you have to think that Mark Smith has maybe seen enough of Magalonis here today.
Might be his last batter. 2-1. Great count for Georgie Shell to throw on a hit and run if he so chooses.
3-1. Well, that vaunted Celtic offense will have to get it cranked up, but they're facing Connor Cuff. And Lyons, and everybody's talking about Providence, but Lyons has come out swinging here today, out hitting the Celtics 8-2. Ball four.
That might be the last batter.
You know, we said it last inning. He just doesn't have an out pitch today. There's one of Mark Smith's assistant coaches, Chris Carlson. His wife, Lisa Carlson, is the head women's basketball coach at Lewis University.
And volleyball, a key sport at Lewis.
Yes, it is. And men's volleyball, outstanding. Women's team is solid.
George DiMaggio still coaching softball?
Yes, he is. As a matter of fact, Lewis won the Great Lakes Valley Conference All Sports Trophy, and they're having a big party tonight to celebrate that. And here comes the new pitcher, Magallonis. This is very surprising. I mean, he's dominated people all year, but he doesn't make it out of the third inning here.
No, he was hit and hit often and hit hard. He'll give way to the stead of Dan Wetzel. 6'145", a diminutive guy who must pitch with guile. His seventh appearance as a pitcher, 2-0, 18 and two-thirds innings. He's given up 17 hits, an earned run average of 2.25, 10 strikeouts and 8 walks in those 18 and two-thirds innings. He has one job and one job only. That is to keep his team in this baseball game and get the heavy lumber of the Celtics a chance to play catch-up baseball.
Well, this is only the second time this year in 40 games that Providence Catholic coach has trailed by this many runs. They one of their losses was a 10-3 setback to St. Rita. But in none of their other games have they been behind by 4 runs with the exception of that game.
Well, this team has been one that's been on a mission. They lost to our Naperville North team last year in the regional, 7-6, 64 pitches, of which 41 were strikes for Magallonis, but he gave up 4 earned runs. They lost 7-6 in the regional final last year. And then in the summer tournament, they lost not once, but twice on the same day, 3-2 to St. Lawrence and Aniqua Valley to be eliminated before Nazareth ultimately won that tournament. And so Coach Smith said that was a very difficult day for him, along with the regional loss. But they pointed at both those things to build for this year. They built for tonight. They're here. They're knocking at the door. But right now, Lyons Township has the hinges on the fingers for the Providence Celtics.
Oh, yeah. They are dominating this game. There's no doubt about it. So here's the situation. Wetzel comes in relief of Magallonis. 2 on, still only 1 out. And Brian Kelly, the left-handed hitting center fielder, digs in. He's 1-for-1 with a stolen base. And Wetzel ready. First pitch, fastball, misses inside, ball 1. The difference between Wetzel and Magallonis, fastball-wise, about 5 or 6 miles an hour. But it's not necessarily how hard, it's where it ends up. And you're right, no movement at all today on Magallonis' pitches. Wetzel delivers a fastball that's fouled up the first base line.
Lyons Township lost their last regular season game 5-4 to a very good Downer South Mustang team, then beat Bartlett 3-0. Schaumburg 6-2 in the regional championship. Tough one against Glenbar North, a very solid team for the DuPage Valley, 3-2. Glenbar West 7-2 victims, and then 6-1 over Streamwood to get here before their first round win yesterday.
Hey, check that out. Do some quick math, Coach. A total of 8 runs had given up in 6 games coming into today.
Wow.
Yeah, 6 games coming into today.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Pitching and defense. Today it's the bats, though, against the Celtics. There's the ball inside. 3-1 to count now. And more activity in the Providence Catholic bullpen. A right-hander up and a left-hander up. Is that Trowbridge down there throwing?
I'll get the glasses on after this pitch.
That is Trowbridge down there throwing.
And if Trowbridge is throwing, that means he went to coach and said, I want the baseball.
There's ball 4, and he may get it sooner rather than later. A 5-pitch walk to Kelly. And we are one gapper away from Lyons Township blowing the doors off this state championship game.
Trowbridge, the left-hander, down in the bullpen. And Zed Zwartniak, the right-hander, double-barreled activity for the Celtics. That probably hasn't happened too much besides sideline session this year as well.
Here now is Danny Zay, struck out his last time up. Bases loaded, only 1 out, pitch from Wetzel. Off-speed pitch, misses. They appeal to first base. First base umpire Paul DeLeonardis says, nope, didn't go around, ball 1.
Scott, this is going to sound ridiculous. 5-1, still manageable for the Celtics.
It is.
6-7-1 makes it much more a steeper hill to climb.
There's ball 2. So Wetzel can't find the plate.
Yeah, so this is a huge at bat by Zay. And then they would turn the liner up over to Spencer Mahoney. So a lot of damage to still keep at bay for Providence.
There were the runners, first, second, and third on your screen. Nowhere to put Danny Zay. Fly ball to left field. Olsta's got a very good arm. It's shallow. He'll catch. Runner will tag. Runner will come home. The throw is cut off. Out! Cut it off, and he threw home. Sammy Travis, a strike. Once he cut it off, I didn't think he was going to be able to get in, but he did.
Book that play right now. If the Celtics come back, you can mark this one. A 7-5-2 putout. We saw it developing. Good play by Lyons. Go ahead and make it Providence. Deliver a play, and they do just that. Great job blocking the play by Botempa.
And a great play, too. Let's look at him block the plate. Watch the left foot. Never hit home plate until after the tag. A wonderful call by Paul Schultz. Lyons had a golden opportunity to blow it open, but still, they have a comfortable 5-1 lead. This is the 4A state championship game between Lyons and Providence on IHSA TV. Wow,
that was a great,
great shot. 5-1 Lyons leads. Top of the fourth is where we go. But first, let's go down to Sophia Minier. Sophia?
Mark, you were just speaking about in the inning before the kind of mental collapses that Providence Catholic suffered last season. You talked about the loss in the regional final to your Naperville North team. You also mentioned the two games they lost at the summer tournament. And so Mark Smith said, our team has all of the physical talents and skills, but we have some work to do mentally here. So pitching coach Chris Carlson, he contributed this Japanese philosophy of nushin. Now, nushin means, you know, control what you can control. And he applied this to baseball, that you need to focus and concentrate on every pitch. Control what you can control. What has happened in the past, leave it there. And just stay in the moment, like you said. Along with that nushin, he had every member on his team read this book, Winning State, by Steve Knight. Now, this is not a book about winning a state championship. It's a book about executing under pressure. It's a book of mental training exercises to get your mind to focus and perform under pressure situations. The Celtics will need to tap into that new sheen and that winning state of mind to get back into this thing, guys.
Excellent stuff, Sophia. Nushin, N-U-S-H-E-E-N, and they need to tap into that mantra right now. Control what you can control. The next at-bat, Potempa's got to control his at-bat, his emotions, and be a catalyst for this offense in this half inning.
Well, they can't control C-U-F-F, though, as in Connor Cuff, who's dealing. He's given up just two hits through three innings. It was behind in the count. Now he's even in the count with that breaking ball. Two balls and two strikes.
Great atmosphere at Silver Cross Field tonight. Big time crowd.
There's a fastball that's spanked. Look out, guys, down the left field line. Bunch of little kids playing in the berm down there. That one would have been too hot for anyone to handle.
Sophia with some great stuff, and I want to know if she's going to buy that book and read it.
You just go online and pick it up for free,
there
right?
There you go.
Curveball misses outside, 3-2. The Lyons fans were not happy about that call, but we saw from our great camera work that left foot never got in until after the tag. It hit the, looked like it hit the
shin guard
yeah. of the catcher. Swing and a miss, strike three. That is just the second strikeout for Cuff. Take another look at it.
Most important out of an inning is the first one.
You see the difference between his curveball and Magallonis.
Yeah, that one just dropped off the table. The adage in baseball, the most difficult out, or the most important out, the first one. The most difficult out, the third one.
Here's Colin McHenry. Yeah, ask a closer that or an eighth inning relief man.
Exactly.
You know, Providence had all these fantastic offensive numbers, and, you know, they were considered the favorite to win this, but, I mean, when you're facing a kid that hasn't lost as a varsity player, to me, that evens the scales.
Are you kidding me? 18-0 on his career.
McHenry swings and misses for strike two. One ball and two strikes. I don't know if that new she's going to work now. Down by four runs with a guy dealing on the mound against you. Look at that, breaking ball. Ooh, almost in there. Thought that was going to be a ring-up for McHenry, but no, it's 2-2 instead. 5-1 Lyons leads. Eight hits already, Providence with just two.
Connor Cuff going to the University of Pennsylvania. Shows what kind of student he is. Georgia Shella told us the other day that the team's average, team composite average, ACT, is around 25.
That's a dream.
So an intelligent team from top to bottom.
Swing and a miss, strike three. And Cuff is on cruise control.
Well, maybe Providence uses Nushi, but right now Lyons using Carpe Diem seize the moment, and they've done just that.
And a changeup doesn't hurt too.
You just pull a string on that change.
Here's Zach Katsoulis, now the right fielder. Zach lined out to center field, his only other time up.
Bad mistake that young pitchers, Little League, Pony League, make, and that their coaches often make. They teach the breaking ball when they should be teaching the straight change first. One, it's the next best pitch. Two, less wear and tear on the young developing arm.
Yeah, very few kids are good at changeups. One ball and one strike on Katsoulis. There's another off-speed pitch right over the outside corner.
But I'll tell you what, if you look at all the winning programs that we can identify, they all have that commonality. Pitchers that the whole staff can throw the straight change.
Two balls and two strikes. See the faces on the Providence kids in the background there. They're wondering if their state championship dreams are over. There's a little nubber. Highland Box squeezes it, and that's it. Cuff continues to keep the Celtics at arm's length. Bottom of the fourth is where we head. Lyons 5-1. Connor Cuff dealing against the number one team in the state. There's one, there's two, four and all. We're at Silver Cross Field in Joliet. If you're wondering, what is Silver Cross? Well, it's a medical center here in Joliet. It's on the east side of town. Next year, we'll be moving just about 4 or 5 miles to the east, and we'll be in the village of New Lenox. They're the sponsor of this fine stadium in Joliet. Been the only sponsor of Silver Cross Field since its inception 10 years ago. Lyons with a comfortable lead, if that's possible, 5-1 over Providence Catholic. And top of the order, it's Mahoney, Heilenbach, and Rotemoyer. And on in his second inning of relief here is Danny Wetzel.
Celtics with 9 outs left. Top of the fifth, top of the sixth, top of the seventh. No one knows better than George Uchella that his team needs more runs to keep the Celtics at bay and out of reach. But Lyons has been just an incredibly disciplined hitting team tonight, taking what the pitching staff of Provs get him, hitting numerous balls to the opposite field.
Wetzel misses outside. It's now 3-1. Mahoney is 1-for-1 today. A single and a run scored and a walk. I like this kid at the leadoff position, don't you?
I love to
watch him. Doesn't look like a leadoff hitter at 6'3", and he takes ball four, but he can run. He's smart.
Great plate discipline. Now been on base 3 out of 3 times.
Hard to find a good leadoff man, isn't it?
But great teams have them, and you're
right. Yeah, they
do. And it's a role that you have to search for and be able to protect. And he doesn't fit the prototype leadoff position at 6'3". But he's able to take a lot of pitches, is able to hit the ball both ways.
Throw over to first base. So Wetzel, again in trouble here. Each of the 4 innings we played here, Lyons has had somebody aboard. They lead 5-1, 8 hits already. There's a curveball to Heilenbach, and he takes. Lights are on, cloudy skies. Quick throw over to first base. Runner back in safely. Temperature upper 60s here today. Had some rain earlier during the 3A games, but nothing steady and nothing hard. Fastball hit in the air toward right field. This one's trouble. Katsoulis going back. Bounces off the short fence. That's going to be extra bases. Cut off by the second baseman. Nobody was covering second. That is a double. And Lyons again threatening to run away and hide. A double by Heilenbach, his second hit of the day.
Leadoff walk was to Mahoney. And then Heilenbach with that double turned around Zach Katsoulis in right field. And another trip to the mound of the Celtics making another pitching change.
Carlson out. And Wetzel is done. Providence just can't get these Lyons Township Lions out. That's 9 hits already.
Let's see what number that is.
Well, it's number 14. And it is Trowbridge. That's what I thought. He's 24 in the book, but that's Trowbridge. who pitched yesterday, and he's going to pitch again today. Went the distance yesterday, and he'll be charged with holding the Lyons, Township Lyons, at bay.
Well, this is almost an unheard of appearance for Trowbridge. This is a situation where he had to be in the ear of Mark Smith. I want to pitch, I want to pitch, I want to pitch. He did indeed pitch yesterday and threw a complete game. We're trying to get a pitch count that he had at some point, but he did pitch seven innings just over 24 hours ago. I think it was 81. I know it was a very efficient pitching effort by Trowbridge yesterday.
Yeah, I'm trying to look here to find it. Not quite sure where to locate it, but we will. But either way, you're right. I mean, he went out there and threw a complete game. It was efficient, gave up just four hits and one run, struck out four. So it's not like he went deep into a count against a lot of guys. But at this point, you know, you say to your coach, here's what I want. I want to go back in there and pitch today. And there were some were surprised that Trowbridge threw that game yesterday, figuring they were the heavy favorite over Prospect. You may want to throw Magalonis instead, but no, you go with your horse in that first game because you can't win a championship unless you get there.
Yeah, you don't want to look back. And again, let me emphasize that this is all Trowbridge just in the ear of his head coach Mark Smith. Intentional base on balls. Why not? Rotemeyer's just been putting a hurt on the baseball. 4 out of 5 in this tournament.
Yeah, 2 for 2 with a couple of runs scored and an RBI today. So here's Tom Walsh now. He'll face Trowbridge. Trowbridge again, not a big kid at all. 5'11, 170 pounds, but he can rush it up to the plate. Let's see if he's got command though. Bases loaded, nowhere to put him. First pitch, fastball upstairs. 87. Didn't lose a lot of velocity from yesterday to today.
I know that going into the seventh inning yesterday, he was at 71 pitches and he had a 1-2-3 inning. So it had to be high 70s, very low 80s, and a very efficient performance.
There's a strike. 88 that time. Tom Walsh, a ground out and a single, a run scored. 5-1, Lyons leads. Bases loaded. There's nobody out. Infield in at all four positions. Here's the 1-1, bounces by the catcher. It's gonna be 6-1. That is a wild pitch. And Lyons extending the advantage. That's Mahoney that scores from third. A nightmare here for Mark Smith and the Celtics. And this is something beyond George Uchella's wildest dreams here in the state championship.
And two more runners in scoring position. The key at bat right now goes to Walsh.
Eilenbach is at third. Rotemoyer is at second. Infield in, still on the grass.
333 hitter, 30 RBIs on the season. Two ducks on the pond right now for Mark Walsh.
Trowbridge, a fastball that's hit out of play. Two balls and two strikes.
Good look at number 8, Tom Walsh. For Lyons, bear down. He's got an idea to right center field here. Move him over, get him in, get him over.
Bat resting on his shoulder. Walsh ready. So is Trowbridge, shot to right field, right at Katsoulis, makes the catch, runner tags. Here comes the throw to the plate. McInerney cuts it off. Nobody gonna catch. A very, very fleet-footed Eilenbach from that deep in right field. It's now 7-1 in favor of Lyons.
Lyons taking advantage, a leadoff walk by Mahoney, and then the blistering double by Eilenbach. Another walk, intentional that one was, but Lyons does what championship kind of performances do, and that is keep adding, keep adding. Nothing is never enough.
And they're gonna appeal to third base, and he is out. Oh my goodness, Paul Schultz. A home plate umpire, and look at George Uchella. He has the hat off, puts it back on. We're going to have ourselves a conversation at home plate.
Well, this will be the second consecutive inning. Last inning, it was a 7-5-2 double play, which wiped out a would-be Lyons Township run. This time, it's an appeal to third base. And Providence gets the call that we don't see very much.
So no RBI, no run scored for Eilenbach. 6-1 the score. And George still talking to Paul Schultz about it, saying, look, the ball was that way. How could you see down the right field line and the third base? I understand what he's saying. How can you see two different ways?
Exactly.
And left you can, and right, can you?
No. And you know what? With the ball that deep, Paul Schultz, in all honesty, he better be 100% sure that he's right, because quite honestly, you know, the Lyons Township runner, Heilenbach, could have almost jogged home, not sprint, with a ball that deep.
In his defense, I mean, why would you make the call if you're not 100% sure? There's a ground ball. Second baseman DeFilippis has it. And that's it. Two innings in a row. Runs that Lyons thought they had. Nope. Providence Catholic hanging around, but it's getting late. We played four. Lyons Township leads Providence 6-1 on IHSA TV. There's a buzz about Silver Cross Field after two bang-bang plays. Lyons 6-1, though. Bottom line, they lead.
Celtics 17-game winning streak, I believe it is, on the line. And the Lyons taking it right at Providence Catholic tonight in all facets of the game. And if it weren't for two outs recorded at home plate, that 6-1 scoreboard would be reading 8-1 at least.
Dominic Ulsta, Matt Trowbridge, and Brady Wilkin, 7-8-9 in Mark Smith's lineup. Connor Cuff has been incredible. Lyons has out-hit Providence 9-2. It's a curveball inside, 1-1.
Now, we've talked throughout the turn about what catch-up baseball is. That's normally when a team is behind, they take a strike. It'd be interesting if Coach Smith wants to do that with his team. And the reason being is Connor Cuff has only walked, 12 people in innings of work? 65 innings. So he's not going to beat himself very often.
He has given up one walk today.
So that would make it 13.
And that would make it 13. Time is called as a ball got out of the Providence Catholic bullpen. Connor Cuff, 18-0 as a varsity pitcher at Lyons Township. Two balls and two strikes. This one's out of play.
Six, 9-0 for LT. And that O being very significant. They've been flawless defensively.
Cuff, long look in. Now he's ready. His pitch right down the middle, strike three. That was a fastball that Ulsta watched go by.
Good movement, good placement, moving the hitter's eyes. Ulsta looking in, got the express on the outer edge, and just flat out frozen first out of the inning again.
Trowbridge takes an off-speed pitch, ball one. Six runs, nine hits, no errors, 1-2-1. Those are the line scores. Trowbridge, fly ball toward left center field. Dan Zay, the left fielder, will catch up with this in plenty of time.
Left-handed hitter, ball to the line, goes to the line. That ball basically spun right back. Good defensive positioning. Zay has an easy catch in stride.
Brady Wilkin will hit now. He was hit by a pitch his last time up. And if you recall, Providence was down 3-1. They had runners at first and second with Sam Travis up, and Wilkin got picked off second base. Wants to bunt and does up the first baseline. Cuff fields, throws. 1-2-3 go the Celtics in the fifth. 6-1. Look at the smiles on the Lions' faces as they realize they're six outs away from a state championship. Bottom of the fifth inning, Lyons in command here in the 4A State Baseball Championship. Lyons Township trying to win a second state title under their head coach George Uchella. Won it in 2003. They went 36-6. And they will send up Lehman, Pett, and Kelly, 6, 7, and 8. Trowbridge continues on, the third pitcher for Mark Smith and the Celtics. Wearing the war paint like all the Celtics do. It used to be that eye black just underneath the eyes was the cool thing to do. Now you gotta have it all the way down to your chin.
War paint.
Yep, war paint. 2 and 1 the count on Lehman. He's 1 for 2. It's fouled back behind us out onto Jefferson Street. Now look at that. And it's not even sunny.
But it looks tough. And he's a gutsy pitcher, is Trowbridge.
Here comes the 2-2. Beauty, right over the outside corner. Pulled the string on it. Here's Pett now. That's a man. Looks like he just digs his hands into a jar and just.
Well, they usually, I'll be honest, they have each other paint themselves up. I don't know why, you know, it's like put my makeup on for me. It's more of an ordeal than I think pregame batting practice.
Coach Lindo, well, we sound like we're traditionalists.
So we are traditionalists.
Suffice to say, if we were playing now, we probably would do it. But back in our day, don't think so.
I don't know how I played without batting gloves, without without metal bats, without hitting camps, without face black.
There's a strike. I will tell you one
Gatorade.
Thing.
We played without Gatorade.
I know. Believe it or not.
Good old-fashioned water did the trick.
Curveball misses. Two balls and a strike. And my dad, you know, playing basketball, no wristbands, no right. Knee pads, no, certainly no headbands.
Nothing to bring attention to yourself.
Ooh, heads up. Fouled back to the screen. Good thing it hit the backstop.
You know, we talked all night singing the accolades of Providence, justifiably so. But, you know, Lyons, 36-4, they returned 7 starters and their top 3 pitchers. So this is not at all a surprise
to them. No, not at all.
They won 24-11 last year with 7 starters and your top 3 hurlers returning. And here they are, 6 outs from a title.
3-2. Trowbridge wasn't happy with that 2-2 call. He thought he got him. Long look in to the home plate umpire. The fans were oohing and aahing. And then he ended up walking him on a 3-2 pitch. So a 1-out walk by Mike Pett. Here's Brian Kelly now, the center fielder. Brian's been a busy boy today. He's been up twice, been on base twice. 1-for-1 with a walk and a steal.
Brian Kelly hitting over 400 on the season. Didn't play for Lyons. He's not one of those 7 returning starters. He had a hip injury last baseball season. Recovered, rehabbed over the summer. Took over the quarterbacking duties of LT's football team. Obviously 100% strong now, but with those 24 wins last year without their starting center fielder and a good one in Brian Kelly.
Swing and a miss for strike one. We were talking about Lyons and their state championship back in 2003. You got to think about this school and the great baseball tradition. 2 second place finishes, 2 state titles, a 3rd place and a 4th place. That's before this year. Swing and a miss for strike two. So when you're talking about premier programs in the state, this team has to be in that picture.
Yeah, Lester Glick took a team to the state tournament in 1950, but then a couple big time names in Illinois High School Baseball Coaches Association, Dick Lieber and Terry Sullivan, both took 2 different teams to the state finals, and George Ushella putting his name in the record books as well as one of the all-time great coaches at LT and in the entire state of Illinois.
School takes in kids from the city of LaGrange, located in Cook County. Popular enrollment are just under 3,900. Swing and a miss for strike 3. 88 miles an hour. Second strikeout from Trowbridge since he came in relief.
And you mentioned the city of LaGrange. Quite a weekend for them in baseball because Nazareth Academy from LaGrange comes in and takes a tournament trophy home as well. So the neighbors each are going to take home some hardware from Joliet.
And Lyons Township, that area, LaGrange, just really good family area, good school, smart kids, tough kids. And we're seeing it here on display against Providence Catholic. There's a strike.
There's an awful lot of communities that love baseball. Lyons, LaGrange, Naz, we just talked about them. The Naperville community, to be honest with you, with Naperville Central, Naperville North, Neuqua Valley, Wabanse Valley. Obviously, Joliet loves their baseball.
Trowbridge delivers a curveball, swung on and missed for a strike. Two strikes the count, 1 on, 2 outs here in the bottom of the 5th inning. Getting late in this 4A state championship game, Lyons in complete command. If you're looking ahead to the Providence Catholic 6th, it's the top of the order. DeFilippis, Houlihan, and Travis. Trowbridge, long look into his catcher, Fontema. And they're going to get the runner picked off. Somebody going to cover second or not? Nope. Ball gets underneath the glove of the shortstop. That is a throwing error and a steal. A steal, no throwing error, just a steal. Straight up steal for Mike Pett.
The reason viewers would want this, why is that not a throwing error? It's a stolen base because on the break, Pett did not try to come back to first base, but basically the official scoring call is that he would have beaten that throw to second. You can't assume an out, so you can't assume an error.
I think part of the problem there was Houlihan was just late in getting over to the bag. He didn't realize, I don't think, what was going on.
And that pickoff was called from the Providence bench. It was relayed from the Providence coaching staff to Dan Potempa to Trowbridge. So an awful lot of communication going on non-verbally for the Celtics.
Pitch to Danny Zay is upstairs. It's one ball and two strikes. So yet another runner in scoring position for Lyons Township. Zay is senior. Open stance on the right side. Here comes a 1-2. Curveball bobbled by Potempa. He'll head out in front of home plate and fire down to McHenry. And Trowbridge picking up where he left off yesterday, but will it be too little too late? We've played five. It's Lyons Township 6, Providence Catholic 1. Potempa dealing some heat. To the sixth we go, 6-1 Lyons. Let's say good evening once again to Sophia Minier.
Scott and Mark, the Lyons just 6 outs away from clinching this Class 4A baseball championship. And George Ushla, he's already won a championship this year. You may not know that George Ushla is an assistant volleyball coach, and they won the 4A volleyball championship this fall. So Ushla said it's great because he says his volleyball team is like built-in fans. He says that a lot of the girls will come to a lot of the games. They're big supporters. And he says one of the things he does with his volleyball team is he does this game face, this very serious lockdown face. And he says that every now and then his volleyball players will yell out to him from the stands, say, hey, coach, game face. And he'll make him do the face. He says it just makes him laugh, relaxes him. Says it's great to have that support. So again, 6 outs away, Ushla trying to get another group alliance, another ring this year.
And if they do, it'll be on the back of Connor Cuff, or I should say the arm of Connor Cuff, who's allowed just 2 hits through 5 innings. And he'll face the top of the order here. DeFilippis, Houlihan, and Travis, and he quickly hangs 2 strikes on the board against DeFilippis, both of them breaking balls.
Now you wear state championship rings on the ring finger of your right hand. He would have a volleyball one on. He'd have to wear that in the fall and wear his baseball one in the spring.
There's a shot into center field. Center fielder Brian Kelly can't catch up to it. Leadoff single for DeFilippis. Finally something for the Providence Catholic fans to cheer about. And when you talk about Providence Catholic, here's a trivia question for you, coach, and I think you're going to know the answer. Which Catholic school has the most state championships in all sports combined? It's, well, Providence Catholic.
I'll be honest with you, I would have guessed Mount Carmel, everything combined, but it is Providence.
Providence with 25 state championships in all the different sports combined. Number one among all Catholic schools in Illinois.
Amazing athletic program.
Here's Houlihan, and one thing when you walk into the gymnasium, Sacred Heart Gymnasium, you see all the posters and all the banners up on the walls, and it'll be track, it'll be basketball, it'll be baseball, wrestling, and football. Very well-rounded athletic program at Providence Catholic. There's ball one to Houlihan.
And you know, you notice a big difference. Providence trailing 6-1. A lot of games throughout the last 2 weekends. When an opponent's down 6-1, you feel like game over. Right now, Providence doesn't feel like the game's over. Lyons knows the game's not over, respect to Providence, and there's not a fan here that thinks this thing's just a matter of time. There's still outs to be made.
Let's go back down to Sophia.
Mark, you were talking about the ring, and it's funny because George Ushla was telling me he actually does the opposite season with the ring. He says during the volleyball season, he'll wear that 2003 baseball championship ring, and then the ring that he's wearing right now on his right hand is actually the Falls volleyball ring. Now, he says he just likes to switch it up during the seasons and likes to use it as kind of a motivational piece for his team, say, hey, maybe you want to get out and get one of these, too.
You're going to ask him if he's going to run out of fingers here.
There's a shot right up the gut. Kelly coming on. Bounces in front of him, back-to-back singles to start the sixth inning for the Celtics. DeFilippis and Houlihan.
And this is a situation as Providence people making some noise. Are they capable of a big inning? Absolutely. Do they need a huge inning? No. They need to just get a couple. If they can cut this 6-3, 6-4, makes the seventh inning much more manageable, so they don't have to get it all back at once.
Providence fans on their feet. Here comes Sam Travis. 16 homers, 73 knocked in on the air. First pitch right down the chute, a change for strike one. Sam nods his head yes, as if to say to Cuff, nice pitch, man.
Nobody warming up in the Lions bullpen. Why would you when you have an 18-0 career starter on the mound?
There's a fastball. He went from 75 with a change to 86 with a fastball. He's ahead two strikes on Sam Travis. Travis took him out of the park in the first inning.
Power against power, the matchup within the matchup.
Lions fans rise to their feet. The pitch fouled off at home plate. That was a change. How can you adjust if you're a hitter?
Yeah, especially when you're all geeked up, you know, you're in the emotion of the moment. He's got to tell himself new scene right now. And I'm sure that mantra is part of their thought process.
Pickoff play back to second, this time not successful. Yeah, I don't think the runners are going anywhere this
Look
time.
Look at how deep Lyons Township is. It's hard to see Brian Kelly in center field. Get the binoculars out.
Travis, a curveball. If it was foggy out there, coach, we wouldn't see him.
A very, very deep outfield. Look at the spacious ballpark, Silvercross, and look at those dots of outfielders, if you will, for LT's Lions.
Once again, the 0-2 from Connor Cuff. Yank foul. Talking to Mark Smith the other day, and Smith said one of the things he's looking forward to is Travis graduating, because he won't have to stand 90 feet away from him when Travis has an aluminum bat in his hand anymore.
Best
he says,
compliment.
Every
yeah.
time I take my life into my own hands.
Best compliment you get as a hitter is if your third base coach moves way back beyond the white stripe.
A third 0-2. A curveball. These are good pitches. I mean, great pitches from Cuff. You see the big release of air by Connor Cuff.
Connor Cuff keeps around the zone. Is Travis disciplined enough if he goes outside of the zone not to bite on a breaking ball away?
There's a shot down the left field line. It's fair. Into the corner for extra bases. DeFilippis is going to score. They will hold Houlihan up at third. It's 6-2. Sam Travis with his second RBI of the game. And he yells to the fans, come on, everybody, get up, let's go.
Well, what Travis did that time, you talk about a quality at bat. Here's another 0-2 pitch, way too much of the plate that time by Connor Cuff, because he got ahead of Sam Travis, and Travis fouled another one off, and then Connor Cuff made a mistake wild in the zone, and Travis flat out heard it, spanked it down the left field line, and the Celtics back in business, one base hit away from cutting this thing to 6-4.
That young man has had one of the great seasons in IHSA history offensively. I mean, how many guys over the years have had 16 home runs and 75 RBIs in 1 year? Check that, 17 home runs and 75 RBIs, coach. Those years just don't happen.
No, big time numbers.
75 pitches, 50 for strikes for Connor Cuff up to this point.
And 50 strikes, I'll go back to my last point. That pitch probably should have been a ball. He didn't want to throw strike number 50 on that one, because Sam Travis is protecting. That's missing in the zone. Connor Cuff, 18-0 in his career, 10-0 on the season, has some work to do. He still has six outs to get.
Pontepa with 46 knocked in, 9 home runs, a .482 average. Second and third, nobody out, curveball outside, ball one. Still a 4-run cushion here for Lyons Township. Cup delivers a fastball in there for a strike, 87 miles an hour. Well, this is what it's all about. I mean, this is the closest 4-run game I've ever seen.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Everybody's on the edge of their seat. People in blue to hold the lead. People in green to try to cut into lead off their seats on the edge.
Missed upstairs, 2-1. On tap, an outstanding catcher for Mark Smith. Time is called. Contempo wanted take a little bit of a moment to rethink the situation. Well, the situation is this. First base is open. Nobody out. Runners at second and third. Providence down by four. There's a shot down the left field line. If it stays fair, it's gone. It is foul. Oh, baby, was that a shot. Oh, my goodness.
Potempa put a charge in that baseball. He got absolutely all of it. Just a smidgen too quick with his top hand. Watch the bat get around it. If he could have waited just a millisecond longer, we would have had a 6-5 ball game. Instead, just an awful long strike.
That is one of the longest foul balls I've ever seen hit here at Silver Cross over the years. Here comes the 2-2. Curveball swung on and missed. First strike three, counter cuff, a pump of the fist.
They talk about a game of inches. Well, that was a game of feet, because you're talking about a 380, 390 foot home run. Instead, a long strike, and counter cuff answers with the punch out, out number one.
Here's McHenry. McHenry is 0 for 2. He struck out twice, takes ball one. Cuff with just five strikeouts, but four of them have been with these two hitters, Pontempa and McHenry. They've really struggled against him today. There's ball two outside. The only other strikeout was to Dominic Olsta, who is in the hole here. Here comes a 2-0, that's ball three outside. And somebody's got to tell Cuff that he's had McHenry's number here today. Just throw the ball over the plate.
Yeah, he got all pumped up after he got the strikeout with Potempa. Then three straight pitches, and mechanics have been out of whack.
There's ball four outside. McHenry was expecting the generous call by the home plate umpire, but no, that's ball four. Well, here's Zach Katsoulis now. He's hit the ball hard twice, both lineouts, one to center, one to right. Or check that, one to second.
You got a double play opportunity, middle infield, Mahoney and Heilenbach, but you got pretty good speed at the plate with Katsoulis.
And right now, Cuff's just overthrowing, and George Usula can't go out and talk to him because he's already been out once.
No, in high school baseball, you can
go out. Oh, you can now.
Yeah, you get three total trips.
There's a strike. Cuff says, no need to anyway, coach. So the tying run is at the plate with Zach Katsoulis. One out. Top of the sixth inning, 6-2, Lyons Township leading. Bases are full of Celtics. Pickoff play, nothing going as Cuff tried that lift and spin to second.
And I think that is a mental play that he probably would like, but he's got to focus home, not on a pickoff at second here.
There's a little number up the first baseline. First baseman will field cleanly, that's Rodemoyer. He'll get the out there at first base to a covering counter. Cuff makes it 6-3. But more importantly, two outs now for Lyons Township.
Well, this is crucial, crucial, crucial at bat right now for Olsa. You get a base hit here, 6-5, man on base, full momentum, that of the Celtics. If Connor Cuff can handle this at bat, they go into the seventh with at least a three-run lead. Huge at bat.
Olsa takes strike one over the outside corner. Olsa this year, 371. With 26 knocked in, including a couple of RBIs yesterday in the win over Prospect.
Sometimes they think games are won in the last inning. This one, this might be the key of this baseball game.
Foul ball, left field side, quickly. Two strikes the count, Dominic Olsta.
Now Connor Cuff had Sam Travis 0-2, threw a strike, fouled off, threw a strike, fouled off, threw a strike, and he heard it down the left field line. He cannot miss in the zone right here. He has to use that 0-2 count to his advantage. Got to trust Brad Taylor to block any curveball in the dirt.
Curveball called, strike three. I was going to say, coach, same count, but there's only one Sam Travis.
Excellent point.
Two runs for Providence, but still Lyons in complete command. We go to the bottom of the sixth. Connor Cuff and Lyons Township, they lead Providence by a score of 6-3 here in Joliet. Bottom of the sixth inning we go. There's Sam Travis. His big double down the line gave Providence Catholic some hope that last inning, but then Connor Cuff closed the door. And now we start with the top of the order for Lyons. They want to pad the lead against Matt Trowbridge. Ball right back up the middle, and Spencer Mahoney has himself another hit, even though Kevin DeFilippis made a real nice effort at second base. That's the fourth consecutive time Mahoney's been on base today.
Two runs and he's on base here. What a great hitter he is here. That ball is out over the plate. He keeps his hands above the baseball and just drives the ball right back up the box. He is a definite prototype leadoff hitter.
Here now is Steve Heilenbach. He's been busy today. This top of the order has been lethal for Lyons Township, which is what you expect. Foul ball out of play. By the way, that last replay, just a great example of the work our people have done. Director and producer and everybody, all the cameramen and women that are down there today, just outstanding job. Makes it easy for us. There's a shot by a diving shortstop, Houlihan. Here comes Mahoney on his way to third. The throw, not in time. Caught Providence Catholic napping. Holsta didn't charge as hard as he probably should have, saying no way Mahoney's going to try to take an extra base, but that young man did.
Now Mahoney has this play right in front of him. This is not a coaching decision. It's not George Uchila waving him around. Mahoney gets the base hit there to lead off the inning, gets himself on base, and then after his leadoff hit, he takes Heilenbach's hit and parlays it into a first and third opportunity. Great baseball intelligence, IQ, and instincts all at once by the leadoff hitter, Spencer Mahoney.
I'll tell you what, if I'm going to start a team, I may start it with that young man right there. There's an appeal down to first base, and Rudemoyer did not go. So Mahoney is at third. Heilenbach, who's been on base three of the four times he's been up today, including a perfect 3-for-3, with the exception of a strikeout, so 3-for-4 in all, including a perfect 2-for-2 his last two times up. And now here's Rudemoyer. He's been on base all three times today. Fastball upstairs. Single, double, and a walk. Pretty good day.
So the 11 at-bats of the top three hitters, only once have they been retired. That's unbelievable. 10 out of 11 on base going into this at bat.
There goes the runner. No play at second base. Stolen base. Heilenbach is at second. Mahoney is at third. Rudemoyer is ahead in the count 3-0. They're going to go ahead and put him on for the second time here today. And here comes Tom Walsh, who's 1-for-3. Nobody out. Providence worked so hard that last inning just to eke out a couple of runs. And look what Lyons Township's about ready to do.
Tom Walsh's brother played for the 2005 Lyons Township team that lost to Mount Carmel. So there's some baseball blood in the Walsh family.
Chris Carlson back out to talk to Matt Trowbridge. I asked him if he's okay. 80 plus pitches yesterday, throwing a bunch here today in relief. Magalona started off the game, just didn't have it today. And you feel real bad for that kid because he'll have this memory. Such a dominant high school career. But there are days like that, Coach, where some days you have it, some days you don't.
Well, what you got to tell a young man like that, you know what, we're not playing here tonight if you hadn't had the kind of season and done the things that you have helped us do all year long and throughout your career. Pinch runner coming in.
Courtesy runner is going to be Evan Booth, junior reserve infielder. The conversation is over. 6-3, bases loaded, infield, as you see right there, first baseman McGinnery is in, second baseman DeFilippis in on the grass as well. And you see right between Trowbridge and the catcher Pontempa, that first place trophy waiting for the winner. Right now appears to be headed to LaGrange. There's a shot of both trophies now. Fastball in there for strike one. Eleven hits for Lyons Township, just 5 for Providence Catholic. One strike pitch chopped to the second baseman. He's going to come home. Low throw, bobbled, safe. The catcher is furious. Look at Mark Smith come sprinting out of the dugout. And I don't have the angle that Paul Schultz does, but if Pontempa had the ball cradled on his chest, then indeed he did have it.
Mark Smith will end up asking for help. That's going to be an error on the throw if it did indeed bounce in.
Right now, Mark, read his lips. Ask for help. Ask him, please. Fine. He said, you never saw the ball. How can you say he bobbled it? 7-3.
Once again, he's saying, how can you see the play?
Kind of what George Uchila was saying earlier on the throw or the illegal tag up that he called. Coach Smith's going to lose this argument.
I don't know if we have a center field shot of this. We're going to see a replay.
Oh, look at George Uchila come sprinting over now.
He doesn't want to get him. There's the throw. It's definitely a short hop. And there it is. But as you see his right hand come back in, we can't see the ball. I don't know if he helped to cradle it or if he knew he was bobbling it at that point.
Look at Coach Uchila. He wanted to hear all what was being said. Now, well, Coach Smith isn't going to win this argument. He's going to go nuts. And he is one of the more mild-mannered guys you'll ever meet in your life. But when a supposed state championship is within your grasp and it starts to slip away, frustration does set in.
Well, the infield was playing in. They got the ground ball they wanted. Your usually sure-fielding second baseman, Kevin DeFilippis, field that ball cleanly. But just short hop his catcher, Dan Potempa, and that will go as a throwing error on DeFilippis.
So the bases are still loaded. There's nobody out. It's 7-3. So Lyons gets a run back that they gave up in the top of the sixth inning. And here's Connor Cuff now. Infield still in at all four positions. Trowbridge delivers a pitch, fisted back to the screen for strike one.
And how much more gas can Trowbridge have in the tank right now? He's pitching on guts and guile. Great shot of him.
Doesn't hurt to have that eye black all over either. Fly ball center field. Wilkin moving to his right, catches, tag, the throw. Safe, wild throw backed up by Trowbridge. Safe at third. 8-3, Lyons Township has its five-run cushion back. Some great base running, great hitting, and just gutsy playing all day by these guys.
They stayed very aggressive. They stayed very aggressive. It was a great advancement by Rotemeyer, third base on that set, this first and third. Getting behind the ball well was the center fielder Wilkin. The relay, safe at home, couldn't block the plate that way. Good backup by Trowbridge. And then the bang bang safe play at third. And you know, if you're gonna win a championship, you gotta handle somebody's punch. They took the two-run punch of Providence at the top of the inning, and bang, bang, they gotta do something on the board themselves to the Lyons.
Connor Cuff has two RBIs. Not to mention his incredible job on the mound. There's Travis, second for one, over to first for two, and a double play. But the damage is done, and oh, how that hurt Providence Catholic. Lyons Township, 8, Providence Catholic, 3. We go to the 7th in the 4A state championship game in Joliet. Cloudy, gloomy view over the first baseline. That's where Providence Catholic and their huge contingent are vacating, or rather are in here today. And clouds over Providence Catholic, yeah, to the tune of a five-run deficit. They have three outs left. Rally caps are on for the guys wearing black, green, and white from New Lenox. It'll be Trowbridge, Wilkin, and DeFilippis, 8-9-1, as Connor Cuff tries to finish off his varsity career a perfect 19-0 with a win here today. We've had some incredible pitchers here in the state of Illinois over the years, but my guess is only a handful of them have ever been 19-0.
Yeah, you're exactly right. I mean, we've had high draft choices, everything else, but you can't beat 19-0.
Island Buck over to first, one away.
Tell you what, if they are able to get these last two outs, you'll go to the last two outs of inning number 6. The Celtics had cut the lead to 6-3. They had runners at second and third. And Connor Cuff got the huge strikeout of Dominic Atzla to quench that rally and keep the score at 6-3.
Brady Wilkin takes ball one. Wilkin, the center fielder, 0 for 1 today. 2-0.
Celtics playing catch-up baseball, meaning you're doggone right. Brady Wilkin's going to take this pitch.
Strike one. What more can you say about what Lyons Township has done? It took on two Catholic League powers and took them both out. There's a ground ball. First baseman Rodemoyer has it. Pitcher covering, steps on the bag. Two away. Well, this team has lost only three teams this year. Downers South beat them twice. Naperville Central beat them once, and York beat them once. They're about ready to say, hey, we didn't get enough credit coming in. Everybody making out like this was going to be a Providence Catholic coronation, but what Lyons Township had was that young man waiting in the wings for the state championship game.
King of the Hill, he has been. And his team to this point, flawless defense, timely hitting, and aggressive base running has been the recipe.
And a whole bunch of counter cuff, who's allowed just five hits. Here's DeFilippis, now the leadoff hitter. Swing and a miss, strike two. Cuff looks like he could pitch another seven innings. Lions fans on their feet. Cuff looking for the punch out. Popped up on the infield. First baseman Rodemoyer squeezes and then celebrates with his teammates. Let's face it, Coach, they dominated Providence Catholic today.
It was a dominating performance by a team of destiny. Lyons Township in front of 3,100 fans. A great electric night in Joliet. A big-time championship, and here comes
the Gatorade. Here comes a cold shower. I can't say enough about Connor Cuff and this Lions team. A kid goes 19-0. This team goes 37-4. They have earned this one, taking out Mount Carmel and Providence within a 24-hour stretch. This is the best team in the state of Illinois in 2011.
An incredibly deserving champion who played at its highest level tonight, all facets of the game. And they rode the big horse, Connor Cuff, to the 2011 Class 4A state championship game. And a beauty of a game it was.
8 runs, 11 hits, no errors for Lyons. 3 runs, 5 hits, 3 errors for Providence Catholic. Winning pitcher, Connor Cuff. The losing pitcher is Brendan Magalonis. Providence Catholic, an incredible year. Ranked number one all season long. They had a championship within their sights, but standing in the way, Connor Cuff and the Lions from Lyon Township.
Lyons certainly excelled in every facet of the game. Lyons took that two-run punch of Providence, came right back, got two of their own to hold them at bay. And then when you can set down that Providence lineup, 1-2-3 and out, with none of those balls being hit hard in the seventh inning, 4-3 put out, 3-1 put out, and a pop-up to the first baseman, and the celebration is underway for the Lions.
Well, congratulations to Lions, another state baseball championship. First, we talked about their title in 1967 with Dick Lieber. George Ushula had one in 2003, and they get another one here, their third state championship in school history. Congratulations to the boys from LaGrange, Lyons Township, your Class 4A state champion here in 2011.
Great weekend in Joliet after a great weekend in Peoria. Last 1-2-3-A-4 champions have been crowned. Craig Anderson, IHSA baseball director. What a great job he did in these two tournaments. It's been fun, Scott.
It has been a lot of fun. Thanks to our entire crew here on IHSA TV. So that's going to wrap things up from Silver Cross Field in Joliet. For Mark Lindo, for Sophia Minier, I'm Scott Slocum saying so long from Joliet, and congratulations to Lyons Township, your 4A state champions in 2011.
Ladies and gentlemen, the director of engineering for the presentation. Lyons player, number 2, Matt Dillon. Yeah, yeah!